Well, we're going to do something a little different the next couple times I speak. This is my wife, Lisa, and she's...
You're so tall.
You do seem tall to me.
These shoes.
But we're going to do a series on Christ-centered relationships. And I thought, you know what, better than me instructing the women and, you know, how to become great wives and mothers, it just feels awkward to do that. You know, it seemed more biblical, you know, in Titus it talks about how the older women are to instruct the younger women. And since my wife is so old, we thought, it's just this principle of those who are, to me, I just see her as this model of a godly wife, godly mother. And thought, you know what, it'd be so much better for her to do some of the teaching to the women on this issue. So it's kind of fun. We had a good time for service. She was pretty nervous.
My stomach hurts.
So why don't you sit down? Okay. We're gonna sit down and teach. It was, which is uncomfortable for me
you
a little bit.
You can stand up.
I can stand? All right, I'll stand for a little while. It was just weird. I was like, I got up here and she was fine. I got all nervous. But I think it's because I was sitting down, and I don't know how to teach sitting down. I got this idea because about a month or so ago, Lisa and I were on a talk show where we talked about relationships. And when we were all done, I just thought, you know what, there really aren't a lot of couples talking about Christ-centered relationships. In fact, I'm not sure I've ever heard a couple talk about Christ-centered relationships. I've heard couples talk about how to have a happy marriage, and Christ is one point in that outline, but I don't believe that's biblical. To say, here's 10 keys to having a happy marriage, and one of them is having Jesus at the center. You know, it's what I read in Scripture is everything is about God, everything is about Jesus, and marriage comes under that. In fact, there can even become an idolatry that takes place with marriage where we put marriage above God, and yet we'll feel very self-righteous in doing so. And yet that's not the teaching of Scripture, and I just realized there aren't that many happy marriages, you know, when you look around. And at the same time, there's even fewer Christ-centered marriages. Because just understand that what we're talking about over the next few weeks is not that the goal is not to have a happy marriage. Because you can have a happy marriage and still come to the end of your life and realize you didn't please God, right? The idea is having a Christ-centered marriage, and in having Christ at the center, I really believe that one of the byproducts of that is a fulfilled marriage and a happy marriage. And yet the truth is a lot of this stuff we are not saying to the married people. A lot of this is because I want to talk to those of you who are single, because I think we just have a warped understanding of marriage and going into it. We want to make sure you have a biblical perspective on that. Because there are some here who you think that, you know, when you're single, sometimes you think, oh, man, once I get married, then I'll be happy. And I just got to go, do you talk to many married couples? You know, it's, you know, but then there's others, and I think this is the growing number, is those of you who are single and you're looking at marriage and going, I don't want any part of that, because I don't know that I've ever seen a marriage that I want to be a part of. And that's sad to me because God instituted marriage. This is something he created and he meant for it to be something so beautiful. And I believe it can be and I believe it has been in our lives. But one of the main things is this idea of putting Christ at the center. And before I even get into it, or we get into it, is I just want to remind you of what I spoke about the last time I spoke. And sorry I've been gone so much. This has been one of the craziest summers, and I don't want it to be like this ever again. But last time I spoke, I talked about the power of God. And it's something that I think we don't speak about enough in the Christian church. And therefore, we have a lot of people that feel defeated or weak. And yet, that's not a good representation of our God. We talked about the power that's available to us. And what was so cool was the week after that, I had a couple of the college students speak. That was awesome, wasn't it? I mean, it was just so cool to hear a college student standing up and teaching the Word of God. You're going, man, if they're doing that in their 20s. I just praise God for the future. But if you remember, Andrew also talked about power and the resurrection power. And then after that, last week, Matt Moore again talked about power and the power we ought to have as image bearers of Jesus Christ. And it's about the strength and power. And I just think sometimes we can come in here and think about ourselves and already feel defeated, like, well, I could never be a great husband. I could never be a great father because it was never modeled to me, or I never got to experience it, or because this, this, and this. And we're already defeating ourselves rather than really believing the power that's in us and available to us. And so why don't you talk for a little bit?
Yeah, I love messages about the power of the Holy Spirit at work in our lives. I feel like every time I hear it, it's like you've been outside on a hot day and you go to get that cold drink of water. That's what it's like when I hear about, you know, the very Spirit that raised Christ from the dead is living inside of you. That power is available to you. You have strength when you are weak. And I think for us as women, because we can be so emotionally based and so feelings oriented, there's a lot of times we don't feel very strong, or we don't feel like we can really tackle this problem that seems so big in front of us, or even this marriage that we are involved in. But just that reminder, just going back to that simple truth, but profound truth, that the very Spirit that raised Christ from the dead is living inside of you. And I shared a verse I was reading this week that I read in a whole new way. It was Ephesians 3. You guys have heard it before, but to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we could ask or imagine. But the part that stuck out to me was, according to his great power that's at work within you. You know, we struggle so much with wanting to muster up our own strength or our own abilities. But God is saying, I am able to do immeasurably more than anything you could ask or imagine because of my great power that's at work within you. I don't know about you, but I need that reminder every day of my life. I feel like I could have it. I do have scripture up on my wall at home, but I feel like maybe that's one of the ones I should add to it, because I need that daily, constant reminder. You know, they always say that children learn by repetition. No, I think we all need to learn by repetition. It's the same truths that we need to come back to. And believing in the power of the Holy Spirit is essential.
She's good, huh? That's why I got her up here. I want to teach a passage today that I've never heard taught in a marriage seminar, and it may even seem weird to be talking about this passage, but I really believe we've got to get this. And it's actually out of 1 Corinthians 7, when Paul is addressing those who are single, and Paul was referring to his own singleness, and he says in 1 Corinthians 7, we'll put it up on the screen, he says this, he goes, "What I mean, brothers, is that the time is short. From now on, those who have wives should live as if they had none." It's a weird verse, huh? Especially when you're talking about relationships. "Those who mourn as if they did not. Those who are happy as if they were not. Those who buy something as if it were not theirs to keep. Those who use the things of the world as if not engrossed in them. For this world in its present form is passing away." You guys, we've got to get this passage, and I know it's a weird one to talk about here, but it's this idea that Paul's saying, look, this life is short. He uses this phrase that time is short. Jesus uses the phrase, the time is drawing near, or the time is at hand, and Paul's wording is the time is short, and the word short here is literally the word contracted. It's like there's this period of time that God has set, and he's saying, look, it's not going to be like this. Okay, we're not going to be sitting here at Cornerstone Church, Simi Valley, forever. The time is short. It's contracting. The writing's on the wall. Your life's going to end. And this is talking about, you know, post-resurrection and just in the sense that, you know, Christ could come at any moment. Okay, so he says, so right now, marriage isn't everything. There's something bigger than that. Okay, we don't have time. People say, well, how come you and Lisa don't fight very much? I'm like, I don't have time to fight. Okay? We've got something to do here on this earth, and I can't sit here and go, well, 4 years ago, you hurt my feelings. You know, I'm sorry, but you know what? I can't do that. I can't sit here and think about, oh, you did this to me, you did that to me. There's something bigger, and we've got to get that. You've got to get this. Is God is bigger than your marriage. This calling that we have in life to display and model Jesus Christ to a dying world is bigger than you having a happy marriage. And when you get that, then the happy marriage becomes a byproduct of that. Mm-hmm. But it's this idea, he's saying, look, I know you're married and you just want to, you know, be all about your family, and that's so easy to do. And we can almost even make that into a good Christian thing to do, is all family first. It's like, no, there's this mission first. And my marriage is a part of that and comes under that. And he says, you know what, the time is short. And so if you guys are he goes, I don't even have time to celebrate. You know, something great happened, good. Let's have a little celebration, but I got to move on. There's more to life. He goes, those who mourn, I can't sit here. I don't have time to be depressed, you know, because my life's going to be over any moment. And you guys, it's between service. And we need to stop and pray for this because... just between service, someone just told me about Greg Laurie, who heads up the Harvest Crusade. Hmm. His son got in a car accident Thursday night and died. His son was 32, his wife's pregnant, they got kids. He was heading to the church, helping to get ready for this big evangelistic crusade called the Harvest Crusade, you've probably heard of. And that's taking place in a couple weeks. And he just says, you know, I think it'd be good for our church to pray for Greg and pray for the family. His son's name is I had it written down somewhere. Does anyone know his son's name? Christopher? Okay. You're right. 33 years old. Riverside County. I'm just trying to put myself in Greg's shoes. You know, in a couple of weeks, there'll be thousands and thousands of people in a stadium waiting to hear him speak. And I try to put myself in his shoes and go, I can't even fathom. But that's what this verse is talking about. You know what? Life is short. And it's so cool that, you know, he was on his way serving the Lord, and now he's standing before him. Okay, so when you read these verses, and I know I talk about this stuff a lot, it's just the reality of right now, Chris Laurie is in the presence of God forever. It's massive. What else matters? And that's why it's like, okay, I know some of you guys are fine, you're not getting, we got to pull this together because there's something bigger going on here. But can we just pray for Greg? Does anyone know Greg Laurie's wife's name? What's that? Kathy? And then what about Chris's wife? Brittany. Wow. All right, let's pray. Father, I lift up Brittany to you right now. I just cannot even imagine... She's pregnant as a mom and losing her husband, a couple that's serving you. For Greg and Kathy, God, what a powerful man of God he's been. Many of the people in this room have been impacted by his ministry and his life. And thousands more are about to listen to him speak in a couple of weeks, if he can even do it. I pray that they would somehow feel the effect of our prayers right now. And that your Holy Spirit would comfort them with comfort that I would not know how to offer. I thank you for their ministry, their love for you. And God, it's just not coincidental that we're on this passage that says we don't, there's just this task at hand and this mission you've given us this life you've given us to share with the world. Even as we heard about Brad going to the ends of the earth to go and share this good news, Lord, I just pray that you give Greg that same type of strength, or if there's someone else that's supposed to take his place for this time, then so be it. God, we want you to be honored in it all. So comfort Brittany, Kathy, Greg. Mm-hmm. I thank you that Chris is standing with you. I can't imagine what he's experiencing right now. What an absolute rush, God, and we can't wait for that day. In Jesus' name, amen. Anything to say?
Sure.
Why don't you say something?
Well, that's a hard thing to follow up on.
Oh, you know, let me say something then.
Okay.
And you can think about it for a while. But you know that passage that we just read? It says, because, could you put it back on there? I'm trying to think that last phrase. This world, that last phrase, this world in its present form is passing away. You got to understand that. You got to get this. Okay, this is more important than your marriage or whatever else, is understanding this world in its present form. This world as we know it, as we have it, it's not going to be like this forever. In fact, it's passing away. The time is near. It's contracted. It's going to happen. You got to catch this. Marriage. Lisa and I are not going to be married forever. We'll be married as long as we're on this earth. But then our marriage ends. Do you understand that? Marriage is not eternal. In heaven, Lisa and I will not be married. The Bible says that very clearly. I think it's Matthew 22, verse 30-ish, that Jesus addresses that and says, look, in the resurrection, there's not going to be marriage. And I know that's, I'll be honest, there's part of that that's really weird to me and a little bit sad. For some of you, you're excited about that. But I've heard people say, well, if we're not married in heaven, I don't know why I want to go there. And I'm saying, then you don't get it. The idea is God has prepared this way of life for us. And when we see him, we are not going to be thinking about the things of this earth, I promise you. You will not be thinking about the house you left behind. You will not even be thinking about the marriage you left behind. It is a treasure so great, and to come into the presence of God is so far beyond anything of this earth that Paul says, look, you gotta get that. Otherwise, you're not going to understand God's design for marriage, because even marriage itself is going to pass away, and we've got to see something that's greater than that. That's why we've entitled this series Christ-Centered Relationships, because Christ has to be the forefront of everything, because we understand that marriage isn't forever, and it's a blessing from God, and thank God for it, but there's bigger things. There's bigger things in life, and when you get that, there's one bigger thing in life, and when you get that, that's when it all comes together and makes sense. And so,
I don't know if you've ever been referred to as high maintenance as a woman. Maybe you know a high maintenance woman. But I thought that's what this scripture is saying to me. There's no room for being a high maintenance woman. You know, having a lot of expectations and needs and desires for our husband that really were meant only for God to fulfill in us. We're to be so satisfied in our relationship with God that we are not constantly feeling disappointed and disenchanted and frustrated that our husbands are just not following along with these ideas in our mind of what we think they're supposed to be to us and do for us. And I just think it's a real dangerous road to travel down for us ladies, that we can let our minds play out all these scenarios, become really jealous over girlfriends who seem to have husbands that are so much more attentive or so much more productive, or I don't know what it is for you, but, you know, constantly looking at what your husband is not, rather than saying, you know what, for some of you, your marriage is so good, you're actually looking at your husband as one of your greatest joys and your greatest blessing, when really what stood out to me was the word temporary. Like, this is a temporary blessing. The thought that I won't be married to Francis is sad to me as well, because I do enjoy him and love him, but it really challenges my heart whether or not I really love God most, whether my first love is for Christ. Our first love is not to be for our husbands. It's to be, and I've even heard so many people, they like to do that, God first, and then your husband, and then your, and then da 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 da. I think we just need to forget all that and just say, God. We need to love God, and everything else will flow out of that. We need to love God with all of our heart, our soul, our mind, our strength. And for those of you who are in a really difficult marriage, that is your hope, that your, I'm thinking, can I read Colossians 3 right now, or am I taking too long?
Yes, you may.
Thank you.
There's a biblical model of submission right there.
Thank you, Master. Since then you have, this is Colossians 3, verse 1. Since then you have been raised with Christ, set your hearts on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. For you died. I love that phrase. For you died. And your life, it's now hidden with Christ in God. And when Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. We have to wrap our minds around that truth. This is not life. Our life is hidden away with God. That's true life. Right now, yes, God has put us here on the earth for a very short temporary time, and he is going to use marriage in your life as one of the ways that he can display his love to the world. And he can use marriage as one of the refining and sanctifying processes. I mean, those of you who have been married know that you were just smacked with your own selfishness once you got married, right? You can attest to it. It is a very sanctifying process to be married and to recognize your own selfishness and your sinfulness. So we can't forget that God is in process with us, and that he is using marriage to refine us. And we can't forget our theology. I loved what Matt said last week. That was so profound when he was deciding whether or not he wanted to travel to Iraq with his family. And he said, you know, it really challenged my theology. Do I really believe what God says? And for us as women, we have to say, do I really believe that God is working all circumstances out for his glory? Do I really believe that God will supply all of my needs? Do I really believe that God has put me in this marriage and that he will do with it what he wants and that he will refine me in the process? I mean, that's the truth of Scripture, and that's what we constantly have to go back to, or otherwise, left to our own devices, we are just down the wrong paths of emotions and feelings and heartaches and sorrow. So we have to get back to the truth.
Yeah, it's like that, you know, how that verse ends. It's like when Christ, who is your life, appears, then you'll appear with him in glory. We've got to look forward to that day. You know, it's like, wow, Christ is going to appear at any time, and I'm going to be in glory with him. And that should be our joy. That should be our hope beyond, you know, the marriage relationship. I think sometimes we put too much hope into this other person rather than that hope in Christ. And I gave the illustration last service. It's like if I had a scuba tank up here and we were underwater, which we're not, but let's just imagine. And it's like there's this one tank and we're fighting for the oxygen. Like, I feel like that's what so many marriages look like. It's, we're trying to grab this life from the other person and you're fighting from it. And yet what God's desire is that I get so much life directly from him. I've got my own tank, okay? God fills me up. He gives me life. I found a fulfillment in Jesus Christ. And so I don't need someone to give me life. I don't need air from Lisa. Like, I'm dying over here. Save me. Rescue me. And she's not over there going, come on, my needs aren't being met. You know, she's got her life from God. You know, and this hope of when Christ appears, man, I am set. This is so good. And so now, rather than both of us trying to fight for air from one another, it's like we both got more than enough. I've got my little tank, you know, plenty of air for my relationship with God, my fulfillment. She's got her tank and her relationship with God, plenty of fulfillment there. And now we just cruise through life together, not fighting over anything. In fact, we got air to give to other people. And so now we just swim around and look at fish. You know, it's just, you know, and I just think too often when we go, you know what, oh, I need her to give me, that's what so many issues are, is you haven't found contentment in your own relationship with God. And so now you're hoping that your wife or your husband will make you content or make you happy, when in reality, only Christ can do that. And you're going to kill each other if you're trying to get air from one another and survive from one another. And it's one of the things I was told when I was getting married. They said, you know, those who are most ready for marriage are those who need it the least. There's a contentment that they could find in Christ. And that doesn't mean that there's not a desire to get married or whatever else, because that was certainly in me. And but it's just this idea of, you know, but I found life in Christ. I don't need someone to give me life. Mm-hmm. So let me say one more thing about that verse that we just read about the time being short. And I don't mean this to be disrespectful, but I've thought about this. I really have, about whether or not I should say this. And I need to, because I'm not just a pastor to those who are younger than me. But as a pastor of this church, I am called to pastor those who are even older than I am, and to be respectful, but nonetheless to share the word of God with you. And there is something that is shocking to me. And it's for those of you who are older, you know, that are in your 60s, 70s, and beyond that even. And I'll read these passages about life in its present form passing away. And I see couples in their 50s, 60s, 70s that are still living for this earth. And I think to myself, because even last year when I turned 40, that freaked me out. It just did. I just thought, wow, you know, I can't believe I'm here, you know. And I know 50 is going to be right around the corner, 60, 70, on and on. I'm already going, man, I gotta think about wrapping this thing up, you know. And I'm going to stand before God anymore. I'm already thinking that. And I would think that age 60, 70, that you're the last thing you'd be consumed with is making your house look a little bit nicer and having a nice retirement. I would think that your mindset would be, wow, any day I'm coming in the presence of God. And it's not time to make my life more comfortable for these last few years. But it's time to say, you know what, let me start living a pretty radical life. Because if I've been living a pretty comfortable life, I'm about to stand before God, and let me really live for the end now. Let me really live to be about the fame of Jesus Christ and his glory, and to care for the poor and to care for those who are needy, and to be an example of Christ to the world, because there's something a lot bigger than this life here on earth. And I don't mean that to be disrespectful, but I would just say, you know, those of you who are older, you really need to take this stuff to heart and realize maybe you've been taught something else your whole life, and right now your eyes are being opened to Scripture, because it is very easy in our American Christianity to just hear that, oh, it's all about you, and God will help you have a happy marriage. God, it's not about that. It's just about God, and let me come under that and be about his purpose and his mission. There's no time, you know, for all these other things. Like he says, you know, those of you who just purchased something, you don't have time to sit like you're going to enjoy that thing forever. And it's not time to go, wow, look at my car. Look at what I have. Look at this. Look at that. Because I don't have time for this. Time's passing away. Time's short. Time is contracted. Time is near. The time is at hand. And those who are elderly, man, it's really at hand. You know, is what I'm saying. And I'm going, man, would you take the word of God literally and seriously and start realizing that we just prayed for a 30-year-old, 32-year, 33-year-old guy. You know, it's just, you don't know. And there's not a security of, oh, but I'm serving God. So is Chris. You know, so was that guy. You know, I got to live for eternity. This is bigger than that. In the next verse there in 1 Corinthians 7, he says, I would like you to be free from concern. And that's why he's saying to the singles, he's saying, look, he says, an unmarried man is concerned about the Lord's affairs, how we can please the Lord, but a married man is concerned about the affairs of this world, how he can please his wife. Next verse, and his interests are divided. An unmarried woman or virgin is concerned about the Lord's affairs. Her aim is to be devoted to the Lord in both body and spirit. But a married woman is concerned about the affairs of this world, how she can please her husband. I am saying this for your own good, not to restrict you, but that you may live in a right way in undivided devotion to the Lord. Okay, Paul's talking to those who are single. He's saying, man, sometimes people think, well, I'm single, I'm cursed, or whatever else. And Paul's saying, man, that might be the greatest thing. Because he goes, you know, in marriage, there's a lot of issues. There's a lot of things that can get you divided and distracted, and you lose focus of this mission. And so Paul's saying, Paul was single. And he goes, man, my interests aren't divided. I'm just totally devoted to the Lord. And he says, if you can pull that off, that's a great way to live. Because you're not divided. And yet, he goes, for those who are married, he explains that, you know what, our goal is still to be undivided in our devotion to the Lord. That's why he says, you know, live as though you're not. Now, that doesn't mean that I ignore my wife or whatever else, because obviously Ephesians 5, which we'll talk about the next time we speak, has to do with the way that I love her and how I model Christ to the world. But he's just, the point of this passage is there is something bigger. And if you can do this better, if you can please God better and reflect him better as a single person, then do that. If you can do it better as a married person, then do that. Just do whatever you need to do. But we don't have time to sit around and cry, sit around and rejoice, sit around and look at the things that we created, sit around and just talk about our marriage. There's something bigger going on here. And this whole idea of undivided devotion to the Lord, for me personally, I believe that I've been able to be more devoted and less divided by being married. Those who knew me before I was married know that I wasn't that great at ministry, and every ministry I touched really fell apart, to be honest with you. And there was something, and honestly, my heart was divided. I would be preaching at camps as a single guy, and I'm looking at my Bible, then looking up, seeing if there's a ring on that finger, you know. Okay, I have to talk to her afterwards. Maybe she needs some counseling, you know. And, you know, it's just... You know, that's just, that. I'm just being honest with you. You know, it's just like, I was going nuts, you know. I mean, it was divided, you know. And there was a sense in which, man, I got married, and it was like my devotion to the Lord. It even clarified things even more. And I shared this last service. But it's like, you got to understand the story of Cornerstone Church. Even for those who don't know, we were married maybe 3 weeks or so when I look at my new bride and I go, you know, we've never talked about this, and I haven't even really thought about this before, but I really believe God wants me to start a church. And I know you didn't really bargain for that getting married to me, and I wasn't ready for that, but I really believe it's what God wants us to do. And that means that I don't make any money. Like, I don't take a salary. I don't even know if anyone's going to show up, you know? And so you may have to work more or something like that. And I don't know, we'll figure this thing out. I'll get another job if I have to. But, you know, it's weird to tell your new bride, hey, I'm not going to make any money. And I remember her saying, and then just throwing the whole thought out of, you're going to be a pastor's wife then, that means, and everything goes with that. And for her to look at me and say, you know, when I married you, I believed that God would lead me through you and that he would lead our family through you. And so if you believe that this is what God wants you to do, then I will stand behind you 100%. And do you know what that feels like for a man to hear those words? That I had never heard before in my life, someone that was willing to stand by my side regardless. And if this thing flops, it flops. We'll figure it out. I believe in you. And And I say that because I don't believe that I could be doing everything I'm doing right now without Lisa. And I also get extremely sad for a lot of my friends who went to school with me and had dreams like me. And yet they married someone that kept them from all of those things. And they're being held back, men and women. And I almost feel guilty telling them about my wife and saying, well, actually, life got a lot better for me once I got married. And I say that to those of you who are single, to really, these are things that we did talk through beforehand and thinking through, okay, how committed are you to this? How big of a, it doesn't matter that you just call yourself a Christian. Are you really committed to Jesus? Because I'm telling you, it's an awful, difficult thing. And I get so sad with some of my friends as they're depressed, you know, and I got to keep encouraging them and go, man, you know what, but you're in it now. And so you got to stick it out and let's fight this thing through. But I share this for those of you who are single, you know, you got to think through ahead of time. Are we after the same thing? Do we both want God to be number one in our lives? So would you share a little bit?
Yeah, I feel like for me, for us as women, it becomes such a battle of our thoughts and our heart, a battle in our mind, because I think how you think about something is obviously going to directly affect how you act towards something or someone. And that's why right thinking is so important, and scriptural, biblical thinking is so important. Because the message that you hear from just about anywhere you look in the world, and sometimes even within the Christian world, the message is always about you, to be concerned about you, and to be thinking about what you deserve and what you need and what you are longing for and desiring, and that you should go for those things and you should get those things because you deserve them. And that is not the truth. As I was praying last night for us and this message, and just thinking about us as women and what we need, I felt like the Lord just said, the more inward you focus, the more miserable you will be. And I thought, yeah, that's it, Lord. I mean, that sums it up. The more inward you focus, the more miserable you will become. If all you can think of is your constant disappointments and frustrations, like I talked about, all the expectations that your husband is not meeting, you are going to be so miserable. Because focusing on yourself is nowhere in here. Nowhere. It says, die to yourself. You are dead. You now have life in Christ. Now you are His. You may be married, but you are a servant of God. You are His child. You're a child of God who happens to be married. You're a child of God who happens to be single. You're a child of God. You are His. That's your life. That's your hope. That's where everything is that you need. You know, we sing these songs, God, you are more than enough for me. And every time I sing it, it's like Jim was encouraging us last week. Wow, really? Really do I believe that? And can I sing that? You're more than enough for me? Because I want to make a lot about Francis and what he's doing and not doing and what he's saying and not saying, how he's acting. So I think for us, we just really have to realize that the battle is going on inside our mind and our heart. It is a battle of our mind and heart. And so that's why we have to be so committed to the truth.
Yeah, you were talking last service about unbiblical messages we hear.
Mm-hmm.
Go for it.
Oh, okay.
It's like a prompting right there.
Oh, okay.
We'll get better next service.
Yeah. I don't know how he does this 4 times. Wow.
You have a great man.
I do. The last verse, yes, when he says, I'm saying this for your own good, not to restrict you, but that you may live in a right way and undivided devotion to the Lord. So for me, knowing that our battle is kind of in the heart and the mind, immediately as I was writing just little thoughts and notes, and I'm thinking, well, yeah, Lord, how How do we live devoted to you when we're so easily distracted and there is so much in front of us every day that we have to get done? Maybe you've got kids or you don't, you got a job. I don't know. Our time is divided. Our focus gets divided. And I thought one of the biggest things that we've got to watch out for is outside influences. You know, what's coming in? And I used his illustration with the scuba tank, you know, that he talked about. We each have our own tank for our oxygen, our own walk with God. If you fill that tank up with something other than the truth of God's word, if you've got a lot of input that is coming from the world's wisdom, which is in direct opposition to everything that God calls us to live by, if you fill it up with the wrong stuff, you are going to sink really quickly. It's so important that we are watching the magazines that we read and pick up and flip through. It's really important that we are watching who we watch on television. Ladies, if Oprah is sitting in your living room, I think you just need to turn it off. I'm sorry. She is not going to lead you to the truth. She is going to pull you down. And so are a lot of those other ladies and those fun, oh, well, it's fun, and it's I just like to laugh, and oh, they have good recipes. Well, I don't care. If there's stuff in there that's going to take you down and tell you the exact opposite of what the scripture tells you, then don't do it.
Yeah, it's not even just those secular sources. I mean, you can go in the Christian bookstore and pick up books that are absolutely unbiblical in their view of marriage. And that's why it's like, you know, I told Lisa, I think we really need to talk about this because, you know, when I read scripture, and I'm a pretty simple-minded guy, I just read through, I go, man, that isn't what this book says. You know, there's obvious teaching in here, and this teaching is not about this life and about your best life now. It's about your best life later. It's about when Christ comes and about what that's going to be like. And so some of these things about, hey, you deserve this, that person wasn't fair to you, you don't want to be a doormat, you don't want to be this, you don't want to be that. I don't know. You sure? Because according to this book, Jesus sure looked kind of like a doormat when he was nailed to the cross and spit on and everything else. And yet it's just this whole, no, you fight for your rights. And here's the thing. I mean, I understand the logic behind it all. Of course, I understand that human logic. But let me ask you this question. If Jesus Christ used that type of logic, would he have gone to the cross? If Jesus Christ used the logic of, hey, look at what all those people have done to you. If God used that type of logic with you, would you be saved right now? What if God says, well, look at these people. Look at what they're doing to me. I give them these commands. They don't obey any of it. No, what does God do? He goes beyond that logic. He goes, you know what? I'm going to show them this type of love that they've never seen before. Even though they're offending me like crazy right now. I mean, I just want to destroy them all. Instead, I'm going to love them. Not only am I going to love them, I'm going to show them the greatest love ever. I'm going to demonstrate a love. I'm going to put on display. I'm going to have my own son go down there, and I'll let them spit on my son. I'm going to let them torture my son. I'm going to let them nail my son to a cross. And this is Jesus leaving the comforts of heaven, and it says, for the joy set before him, he goes, you know, I'll suffer all of that. I'm going to suffer all that for their sake. And we're here, we're sitting in this room with joy and everything else. Why? Because the sacrifice that Jesus made, he came down and died on the cross for all of our sins so that we could be forgiven. Okay, that's not a logical type of love. That's not the type of love you're going to read about in the magazines. That's like a supernatural, sacrificing, suffering type of love. And then he says to us, it's a crazy love, really is what it is, which is a great title for a book. It's this idea of, available at Barnes & Noble's for $13.99. It's this idea of, I want us to get that through our minds and just kind of wrap up with this, is God's love for me was absolutely insane. He did not think about what was fair. He just loved, 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 forgave, 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 sacrificed, sacrificed, suffered, suffered, suffered. And I thank God for that. And my job on this earth, like Matt preached about last week, is to be an image bearer of Jesus Christ. Not to show the world a guy who's fair and says, hey, if she does that to me, this is what I do to her. You know, and she make. No, I'm here to be like Christ. And I understand the logic of the world does make sense. But I'm saying if Jesus followed that type of logic, he wouldn't have gone to the cross. And he wouldn't love me right now. But as it stands, Jesus Christ is crazy about me. Despite everything I've done, he's forgiven me over and over again. And so in the same way, my first priority in marriage is to give that picture to the world of regardless of what Lisa does. And you guys see her, and you know, and obviously she's a great wife, but she ain't perfect. And and I'm less perfect. And there are those times when you just go, you know what? It's not about fairness. It's not about what I owe her and she owes me. It's about being like Christ, which means I'm going to love in spite of this, in spite of that. And I really don't have time to fight about these things because time's running out and I'm going to be before the Lord and he's not going to ask, did you have a happy marriage? You know, was she fair to you? Did she do this? Did she do that? It's just like, did you show the world a picture of me? And I want to show the world that by my marriage. And that's bigger than my marriage. Any last thoughts?
That's just the last thing I wanted to say for those of you who are, you know, you come into the room maybe as a woman without your husband and you hear about Christ-centered relationships and you immediately feel that twinge in your heart because you think, well, I can't have a Christ-centered relationship because there's only half of us here. And I just want to say that you can have a Christ-centered heart, and that is what God is asking of you, is to have a Christ-centered heart. And you can honor God in your marriage, even when you are married to a man who does not believe. You are his ambassador to your husband, and I don't know what that feels like, but I can assume that it can be very tiring at times. But again, that's when we go back to our theology. You have got to fill your mind with the truth of Scripture. You do have the Spirit of God inside of you. He has put you here for a reason. You can be Christ's ambassador to this man. So do not lose heart.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I know there's a sense of misery in that whole idea of here's this person you love and you can't share the most important thing with them, you know? And for some of you, you chose that because you knew the Lord. And you chose to marry someone who didn't love the Lord or know the Lord. And so that's some of the consequence of our sin. And yet for others of you, it's because you came to the Lord later in life. And you were married as, you know, people didn't know Jesus. And suddenly you fell in love with Jesus. And he didn't or she didn't. And it's just a very, very difficult road. And that's why I said, you know, with Lisa, I just go, you know what? It is something where you have to work on your own heart. And know that this is something that you have to suffer through and work through and pray for your husband or your wife or whatever else. But again, you can get that life. You need that whole oxygen tank example more than anyone else because you realize, okay, I really do need to get it all from God. And if that's you today and you say, you know what, I've never really given my life to Jesus. I've never really made him first in my life. I've idolized marriage or family or whatever else, and it wasn't that I really fell in love with God. I mean, I want you to understand, baptism really is like a marriage ceremony to Jesus Christ. It's that time when you publicly confess, I'm dying. I'm done with my old life. I'm going to rise again, and I'm going to join myself with Jesus Christ for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer. You know, it's forever. And if you've never made that decision, that's where it all starts. I don't even know how to begin counseling you in your marriage if you're not right in your relationship with God. Because like I said, biblically, marriage is just such a small piece of the puzzle. The overarching truth is this life is about bringing glory to God. And I thank God that I have a wife that stands with me and we do that together in life. And that's what we need to be showing in this church. Those of us who are married is That, you know what, as much as we love our marriage and our family, there's something even bigger than that, far bigger than that. And that's the message I don't hear from marriage seminars or whatever else. And I believe it's the message that the world is lacking and that we need to put on display. So the worship team's going to come up right now, and I want to pray for us. And if there's anyone that needs prayer or you want to get baptized, give your life to the Lord, there'll be people up by the prayer room to pray with you during the worship time. But let's pray. Father, I thank you that you created marriage. I think it's wonderful. I think it's awesome. I've just had so much enjoyment, and I don't know what life would be like without Lisa. And yet, God, I also know that there's so many people here who are consumed with marriage, either because it's so awful right now for them or because it's so good that it's become their idol. And God, I just ask that we would learn to put you in your rightful place. I pray that your word, just as we spoke it and just taught out of 1 Corinthians 7 and out of Colossians and out of Ephesians, that these passages would come to life and that we would listen to these things more than we listen to the messages of the world, the magazines we read or the celebrities we hear from. God, may we be about your word. I just pray for everyone in this room that we'd have wisdom even as we read through books that are written by Christians, that we make sure it really does square with what your word says. So right now, Lord, would you heal marriages, yes. Heal hearts, empower and encourage through your spirit, even as we worship you. In Jesus' name, amen.